first speaker this morning. Thanks for being here early and being here on time. I'm going to do my best to keep on time because I'm always a little bit over. But I think about 45 minutes to talk a little bit about my practice, what I do, but also something I'm calling Designing for Scarcity, which is a new talk for me. It's a new talk for me, a new idea. I've been playing around with this for about a half a year now. And with that said, if you have any ideas or any projects that you think might be appropriate to think about in this context, just let me know. But I teach at Parsons School of Design in the Integrated Design program. It's not graphic design, it's kind of a mixed program. And I have a design studio called Many Design. And it's largely a communication design studio that we've been morphing into different kinds of design as well. I'll talk more about that in a minute. But this is my second time here. I was here about 7 years ago and was able to speak in this room. It's a great venue. I feel like this is like command center down here with this in the spaceship. But I went to the University of Pittsburgh. This was back in, I don't have to tell you how long ago it was, but I went to undergrad there and I studied not design. I don't actually think they have a design program. I think they have a fine arts program and Carnegie Mellon is close by, but at the time I really didn't know what design is and whether I had a future in it. But this is obviously, if you've ever been to Pittsburgh and around the area, this is the Cathedral of Learning. Spent a lot of time here. People at Carnegie Mellon call it the Tower of Ignorance, just because there's a nice healthy rivalry between the schools. And when I was there, I studied a program called Politics and Philosophy. So I spent a lot of time thinking about political science, political theory, philosophy in general. This guy who's staring you down, I realize it's kind of an intimidating photo. He was the person that most inspired me in that program of everybody who I read. His name is Ludwig Wittgenstein. And the professor, John McDowell, came into the classroom and we were just reading part of one of his books, of Wittgenstein's books. He came into the classroom and he told us, if you want to continue studying philosophy after this class, leave the class now. Within 5 minutes, he told us to leave because Wittgenstein's philosophy is kind of anti-philosophy. It's not about creating more of a nuanced understanding of a very specific part or silo of philosophy. It's about, or at least the focus of this class was about thinking about how to describe a larger body of knowledge and experience and reality so that we could communicate across different disciplines. And that's, I look back to this moment in this class as one of the defining reasons why I'm a designer and kind of my instincts and interest in design. It was not an easy class, so I went back and was reading some of these papers and I don't know how to understand them. So anyway, flash forward a bunch of years. I'm now a designer, I live in New York City. And when I first got interested in design, it was in graduate school at MICA. And when I was there, I started doing three things that I really had never done a lot of. Writing in a more creative nonfiction way, teaching, and also designing. And so these are three things that I cannot let go of and are still part of my practice now. And I also learned about socially driven design and the importance of designing not just the thing, but experience or service that actually can improve an organization or a community that has a need. So I think about that in the context of today and what it means to how I might sort of phrase how that fits into the themes of the divide. And I think this is one of my guiding questions, not just in my practice, but even for today's talk, is how can the three parts of my design practice actually bridge silos and divides? And I think that's kind of how I've been guiding my practice. And so when I look at the work that I do and the work that I like to do, these are some of the things that, in terms of topics, that I would chomp at the bit for. You know, the kinds of really juicy social, economic, environmental topics where there's a cause behind it and a community in need. This is probably one of the holy grails of design, is how do you measure impact? And it's something that I think about a lot in my practice and a lot in the way that I communicate to people about what I do. So conversations start with these kinds of questions of what kind of impact you want to have. My studio is called Many because I wanted to sort of broaden the possibility for it. And it's a small studio. Usually it's me with a couple of people working on specific projects at a time. But we do a range of work. It's I really only work on projects that have that support in some way a progressive agenda, social, sustainable, environmental, economic, and so on. And I work across mediums, so everything from environmental to digital to print as well. I'm going to talk about a couple of the projects, and I'm going to think about specifically some of the topics that we're talking about with this conference, and how do you bridge silos and so on. This is a project which is ongoing. I've been working with this organization called Makan for about 5 years. And Makan is, they're all Palestinian. They live in London, but they're focused on not the political issues. They're focused on the human rights issues. And so this is a website which essentially is focused on how to describe and introduce people to some of the human rights issues that are relevant to people in Palestine. And essentially what they're trying to do is be a format for journalists and for outlets to learn about some of those issues which might not otherwise be talked about. Another project that I'm working on is with Mark Randall and World Studio, who you may know of through AIGA scholarships and such. He was a medalist a couple years ago. He's just one of the nicest people you'll ever meet. And we're doing something called Neighborhood Design Lab, where we partner with the city's small business services in New York. And they are basically, we're giving seed funding to 4 different neighborhoods every year that have some need of resilience. How do you protect from gentrification? How do you protect from environmental problems that might be occurring in the future? All these kinds of things. And so we always start with the same questions of, reframing what they come to us with. So they apply for a scholarship, and then we have what we call creative sessions, which are usually 2 or 3 different occasions of meeting with stakeholders. This was last week in Brooklyn, Sunset Park, an area which is being threatened by rezoning and a lot of things that might happen as a result of that. The budget is small, so we don't design big things. We design a strategy with some assets that they can use. And so each one of our clients or partners gets one of these decks, which is essentially a style guide along with all the assets that's included within. So they're about 30 or 40 pages long, depending on the client and the problem. In this case, we're working with Coney Island, and they have 3 different stakeholders who are not cooperating, and so we developed a campaign to help them find a way of having a more of a sure footing as a community. Another project that I did with the city, this is actually with the Mayor's Office of Immigrant Affairs and New York City Public Libraries, is to redesign citizenship workshops. So they have workshops that actually are run all across the city every weekend, usually a few weekdays as well. And essentially what they're doing is trying to educate and help people through the process of becoming a citizen. The challenge, which was a really unique challenge, was how do you also help them become more financially stable? Because most likely they don't have a lot of money, great jobs, and they have a very challenging way of navigating through the process of becoming a citizen. It's expensive. And so it's not very sexy design, but it's got there's a strategy behind it. There's a system in place. And in this case, it's a series of booklets that lead people through the process of becoming citizens. There's a video that accompanies it. This is a project that I work on with a school that I've been a longtime partner with, I think for 7 years now. And they're up in northern Manhattan, and they were given a building that has two different buildings that they combined. But there's no sense of how to get through the buildings, and so we designed a whole series of wayfinding signs and also a variety of other materials that can help people figure out how to navigate through the building. This was probably one of my funnest projects because I was able to create stencils that were actually as tall as I am and was able to paint them all. I think it was over 100 stencils in all. And I continue to work with them. So Medicare, another issue which a lot of people, which is debated by people for some reason. But for some reason, there are organizations that support support promoting it, of course. And this one's the Commonwealth Fund. And so we created a website to help commemorate the 50-year anniversary, which was a couple years ago. And essentially, it's just milestones to go along with it, but it helped amplify the importance of it. Maybe one of the biggest projects I worked on was for the Center for Architecture, which is right there in Greenwich Village in New York. And they have this annual member show where anybody who's a member of the center can show their work. And it's kind of a pay-for-play, so they have to give money to do it. But essentially, it's a chance for them to show their work. And I was warned before going into this project that it was a bit of a, they can be a challenging client to work for. And so I just sort of check myself a lot of times to make sure that we were really moving productively through the process. But it became a project that I'm very proud of, and I still collaborate with them. And they have a lot of programs happening, and they're doing really important work. I've done other work about, you know, the heat in New York City and heat in other cities that are, you know, largely paved over, things around resiliency as well. This is some of the infographics that go along with the, we had to cram 455 pieces into this space, which was really tough, so we built some infographics to help with that. And Eduardo Palma, who's an amazing designer, former student of mine at Pratt, but he was instrumental in helping this happen, and continues to make great work. We collaborate occasionally. On the environmental front, another topic around climate change. Why is it still debated? I don't know. But this did not focus on whether or not it's true. It focused on the people who are doing something about it. And so the scientists, the artists, the designers, the politicians, the advocates were featured on these large, it's a large traveling exhibition, these large banners, which were made out of a recyclable vinyl material to make it even more sustainable. It traveled to Marseille and to Paris and to Berlin as well. So it became a really fun project. And I just got an email from Human Impacts Institute a couple days ago about doing a new version. So well, hopefully that will happen. It also was a transmedia project, so they incorporated different kinds of media into the installation so people can actually listen to interviews. A project for immigration advocates. This came out right when Trump was elected and right when everybody was getting afraid of being deported. And essentially, this organization provides free legal services, pro bono legal services, to immigrants who are in the process of maybe having to go home or to their home country. So this was a chance to promote the stories of those people and provide assets and help to them. Lastly, of my own work that I'm going to show today was, and it's not this it wasn't necessarily a challenging project from the conflict point of view, but I love doing print. I like making books, and so this was the one book I wanted to show. This is from the Transdisciplinary Design Program at Parsons. I created the book, the 480-page book that actually allows them to show their thesis as a group. And this was a fun process of working with them to create templates and have them fill it out and then go back and refine it. And it was an iterative process with them. So I kind of see all those things as examples of some of the ways that you sort of navigate conflicts, I would say in general. But that's just one part of my practice. The other part that I wanted to talk about, or two other parts, one is education. And I've been teaching for almost 10 years now. The kinds of classes that I teach changes, and it's changed largely because of the school and the curriculum. But you know, in brief, I teach three different kinds of classes. I teach skill-based classes, strategy-based classes, and I also teach classes where we actually engage with external clients. And I'll talk about one of these in just a couple minutes. But I find these to be really, all of them to kind of work together harmoniously. It's fun to have two different kinds at the same time. But you know, I'm relatively still young in my teaching career, maybe I think 9 years now, and I continue to learn about the process of motivation, helping students in the classroom. Education is changing so much. They're coming in with a lot more know-how and technical knowledge, and it's not so much about teaching them the skills as much as it is helping them find ways of collaborating. And so for me, I look for insights to help me help them. And this is obviously a pretty funny image of I don't teach infants, but I think about the emotional relationship students can have in class with each other and also with instructors. And there's a lot of evidence and research around the importance of creating what two researchers call a social brain in the classroom. And we're hearing a lot more about emotional intelligence as well. But this in particular is talking about what's the difference between learning off of a screen and learning from people. And in this study, they found that even teaching infants the sounds of the Chinese language, that they absorb it and learn it and enjoy it much better if they are if they have a tutor or a person actually communicating it to them. So for me, I think about how we can add this kind of insight into classrooms, and it's never easy. Because at times you become a pushover because you just want them to have a good time, or not have a good time, but to actually collaborate in ways that are beneficial to the project. But you know, so there's this balance to find in the process. I like this quote from an article about their research, which talks about the importance of having a strong emotional connection in the classroom. You know, if we're not strong emotionally, there's all kinds of challenges that might happen over the course of a semester. So in particular, information is plentiful, but motivation is scarce. So how do you motivate students? And I think this is one area that I'm really interested in exploring more, and I've been trying to incorporate into my classes. So one project that I want to talk about in my classroom is it's an ongoing project. It's with Freshkills Park, which used to be the world's largest landfill, located in Staten Island. All of New York City's trash went to Freshkills Park for over 50 years. And we, myself and John Roach, who's my teaching partner for the project, led a class where we asked students to specifically to think about how we can use data about the park, about the environmental change in the park that's taking place, as a way to get people to experience or want to experience the park. And so that, it became fun because we can go out to Freshkills Park. It's really mounds of trash covered in grass and different layers of engineering. And the tallest mound is actually taller than the Statue of Liberty. Tells you how big, or how long really, the trash was being piled up there. You can see it's about 10 miles away to New York City downtown, but you can actually see it from the top of the North Mound. There's four different mounds. And in 2020, it's going to open to the public. And so the students went out and did a bunch of talking with people who are actually were visiting the park for one of these discovery days, they call it. I'm going to talk about two different projects that came out of that. One is what my students called plant-based design, plant-centered design, not human-centered design. So they took data that was coming out from, we have this sensor located at the park that tells you how much rain's falling there, how much humidity is there, how green the grass is, how green the plants are. And it comes as like a spreadsheet full of numbers. And so they took this and they converted it into musical notes. And as the plant, or as the weather changes, so does the music change. And then it plays back to the park. So it's the idea of, you know, if you play music to your plants at home, will they grow faster? Apparently it might. So this is a prototype that we have, and we're still finding funding for it to make this happen. But by 2020 is our goal that we're going to have this exhibited. We're also working with a school which the students can actually see Freshkills Park from their windows of the school. And we're working with them to come up with a curriculum that can leverage the location of Freshkills Park as a way of helping them understand sustainability issues and ways of just kind of checking their consumer behavior. And so this is a toolkit that's going to be open source, and we're actually going to be modifying it so it's not just about Freshkills Park, it's about any kind of place where there's a recycling center or a trash center in any community around the country. And lastly, writing is the third part of my practice, and it's something that I've been doing a lot sort of casually, but never really formalizing a method for myself until a couple years ago I put this together. And it's my way of thinking about how to go back to my work, my writing, and make it better, really, make it simpler, and connect with more people who might otherwise not want to read it. And so as it goes, good stories have a strong narrative. They vividly engage readers' senses and locate them in a place and time. And of course, there's a lot of details within that sentence. So within narrative, what's a narrative? There's a lot of different ways you can talk about narrative. Plot, setting, pacing, so on and so forth. Conflict, so important for narrative. Senses, there's upwards of, I think, 33 senses that that they say we may or may not have. But you know, five commonly accepted senses. I added temperature here too, But when you think about temperature and you add that to your writing, like it's kind of cold in here, at least for me, I'm always a little cold. But when you add that to your writing, you give a sense of embodiment for the reader. Place, all these different places have different connotations and can completely change the story of where somebody is. And time. If it was 3:30 p.m., it would be very different than 3:30 a.m., obviously. So you might ask questions if the timing is mixed up. A first date, very specific connotations around that. Hopefully good connotations around that. But in any case, this is a way that I use, a kind of a tool I use for myself. And you know, I've used it in multiple projects. Designing for Social Change was a book that I put out a couple years ago, or actually longer than that, 7 years ago, and incorporates projects like this. I would collaborate on a book with a couple other people, Mariana Amatullo, Liz Danzico, and Brian Boyer, about social innovation design in the United States. It includes conversations between thought leaders around the topic, and it also includes case studies and other things like that. If you're interested in this topic, there's actually an open source toolkit. It's more of an educator's guide that includes half the content from the book that you can download, and it's really meant for educators to use in their classrooms. So you could, it has questions for discussions, it has ways of sort of pacing it over the course of a semester, and it's free from this link. And this is the first time I'm showing this, but we're working on a new book, which is a global version of that. Brian Boyer, Mariana Amatullo, Jennifer May, and I. And so this is going to be, you may be hearing more about this in the next couple of weeks. We're starting to reach out about where is this happening in the world. It's probably not the same as what's happening here. And so let's talk about the differences and help educate each other about what the about what's happening and what we can learn from it. Because that's kind of like some of the ways that I've dug into this topic on my own. But, you know, what causes some of the conflicts that we talk about when we talk about this divide? And this gets to the crux of my topic in particular around scarcity. So I was looking into this topic for a while, and I came across this book that came out a couple years ago. And I really like the way they talk about scarcities, because it helps puts us all on the same plane. So when you think about scarcity, most likely you think about something like this. At least Google says you think that. If you do an image search, this is what comes up. Lack of water. So resources is a big point of scarcity that we all think about and consider. Money, environment, things of that sort. But as the authors point out, scarcity can be anything. And it's really specific to you. And so when we think about what design can do, we have to consider where people are coming from in particular. So the need that we feel, that, you know, as it says here, scarcity is having less than you feel you need. And the need can be really anything, from something very practical to something that you might otherwise just desire. They describe a scarcity mindset. So when you're really wanting something and you're really focused on that thing, that's at times all you can think about. Living in New York, what I always think about is how small of an apartment I live in, and I can't wait to get into a bigger apartment. So I think a lot about that. I mean, money for other people, for food in other cases, it's a whole plethora. But it becomes an obsession for us, and there's a lot of sort of processes at play here. They describe the process of tunneling. So tunneling is really kind of narrowing your focus on that one thing that you really are wanting or feel you need. So if you go to a grocery store and you're hungry, like I do this, I go and I buy way too much food, right? That's a scarcity. But you know, in the process of overshopping because you're hungry, you might actually be ignoring the fact that you shouldn't be spending that much money on your food. So it becomes a kind of a blinder on us. There's also this idea of bandwidth. So once we start tunneling, We don't think about other things that are around us. I mean, I know it's implied in the last couple of things I was talking about, but it essentially forces us to become a little bit less sharp about what we're discussing, or what we're thinking about, or what we're supposed to be doing. We also act on our impulses more commonly. So what does it all mean, especially in this context? There's you know, you can draw any number of conclusions from this, but what I am especially interested in, based on this research, is that as we think about design and we think about empathy, because we hear a lot about empathy, I rarely think about the scarcity that's surrounding people. We talk about empathy and we maybe create caricatures of or personas of people. We look at what some of their challenges might be. But when you think on even a more personal level, there might be deeper motivations. And so I think about strategies a lot and think about what kind of strategies we can use to build more empathy. And I'm going to show some projects. And I'm not sure exactly how much time I have. So if anybody, I'm going over, just let me know. Oh, good. So I'm going to show a bunch of projects that are not my projects, but people, artists, designers who inspire me and who I think tackle some of the issues around, you know, specifically strategies that we can look at. And if anybody has any other strategies or any other project you think would be useful, please let me know afterwards or even in the Q&A. So reducing stereotypes. This is a project by Ramzi Masri. It was featured in my first book, Designing for Social Change. And Ramzi is a mixed ethnicity. It's a really interesting background, incredible designer. And when he was an undergraduate, he created an educational curriculum for some schools to use, where basically it was a book exchange. So he used abstract shapes as a way of describing what it's like to be marginalized or, to experience prejudice. And after students who are 9 or 10 years old read this, they would then go ahead and reflect on that and talk about their own experiences. Then they would exchange it, and they would find out that there's a lot of similarities between each other, even if they have very different backgrounds. This is Ramzi up here. I like this piece. It's actually a bit of research that comes out of his project from Charles Hurst. He talks about stereotypes and really generalizations. We do a lot of that, of course, about each other, about the people we don't like. The news does this for us as well. And so it's this idea of familiarity. The more familiar we are with each other, the closer we are, the more space we share with each other, the more chance that we will avoid drawing unfair conclusions about people who might otherwise be perfectly nice to us. The next project is focuses on helping strangers connect in public space, and it's more of a concept that some of you might be familiar with called triangulation. And it was introduced by William Holly White, who in the early 80s created a whole series of videos where he just watched how people act in public space. And one of the things that he noticed is that people tended to interact, two strangers would interact, if there's something external, like an external stimulus in front of them. So you can probably imagine what those might be. Here, I see a lot of art outside. Maybe that would be something. But, you know, a couple examples. You know, this is an interactive, it's kind of like a water pipe organ. It's in Canada, I think on Ontario. This is a park bench, the simplest form of getting people to interact. And water fountains are quite frequently put into this bucket as well. But you can think about public art, you can think about water fountains. In New York City, we have a lot of street performers, and so that's a way that you can see like maybe 200 people gathered around. But it's the idea of breaking down the barriers or putting some sort of grease on the wheels of interaction, so to speak. The next one focuses on creating a forum for the community. It's one of my favorite projects, Matthew Mazzotta. He is actually a social practice artist who does a lot of work as an architect as well. I think he brings that practice into in the way he engages with communities. This was in York, Alabama, and essentially he was working with the community to figure out ways of bringing them together more. And he saw this old house and turned that old house into a place that they can gather. So he took the wood from that house. It's actually able to open up, and it can become any number of things depending on what they needed to be. A place to have a conversation, to watch a movie, to have a political debate. I think the next photo they have a party, probably a musical event of some sort. So it becomes a fantastic place to gather in this otherwise small town. Starting conversations about flood zones and climate change. This, another topic which for some reason it's controversial, but Eve Mosher has been working on this topic for a long time. She's an artist in New York City who's worked internationally, but she decided to show people where the flood lines would be around New York City when the temperature rises. And so she literally walked around the contours of New York City. This is maybe 10 years ago or so. And she had one of these baseball chalk markers and essentially created a way of having conversations with people. Anytime you would walk to a bench or walk in front of somebody, they would probably ask her questions. And we have, and she has documents that can go along with educating them about what she's doing and why she's doing it. It traveled. It wasn't just in New York. It was in Miami. It was in a couple of cities in the Mid-Atlantic region as well. And I know she's always looking for people to collaborate with. So if you live in one of those places, you can reach out. The next one is creating a space for controversial discussions. This is actually not too far from here, or I should say was not too far from here. Conflict Kitchen. Has anybody heard of this in Pittsburgh? Yeah, for you? Yeah, I found out about it maybe four or five years ago. And I love it. I just think it's an interesting model for how to bring people together. Of course, food is the way that everybody will come together. You go to a party, everybody's not in the cushy seats in the living room. They're in the kitchen trying to get some snacks probably. But they only serve food from countries that have some sort of conflict with the United States. And it's, again, it's about greasing the wheels of interaction, having conversations about countries which otherwise would people are very nice, I'm sure, and have a lot in common with us. But they feature the food of Iran, North Korea, and I still don't know what North Korean food would be like. Venezuela, I'm sure that was really good. But I think it's a great example of ways that you can get people to connect. And I think they went out of business maybe a year and a half ago or so. The last one focuses on humanizing public service. And probably one of my favorite projects ever, because she, Marielle Ukeles, if you don't know who she is, she's an artist who has been the artist in residence of the sanitation department in New York City for over 40 years now. And the process of her work is essentially getting to know the people better, you know, the sanitation workers. And so her project, Touch Sanitation, literally is touch. She shook the hands of every single sanitation worker. I think this was one of her first projects with them. But doing this for over the course of a year. And she continues to have different kinds of art pieces and installations and interactions with them. This is another one where she actually covered some of these sanitation trucks with mirrors, so that we can remember that we have a connection to the waste that we're creating and that it's taking away. She's also, I mentioned Fresh Kills Park earlier, she's creating an installation, one of the only installations at the park. So it's, and she continues to be very active in this field. Maybe one of the things that I like about her most and about her work the most, and I think that maybe one of the parting sort of thoughts I'll leave you with is, if we're really trying to talk about overcoming divides and conflict and using mediation, you need time. And that's what impact gives. I mean, that's when impact happens, is when you give time and dedicate time to it. She spent 40 years. That's a long time. But really, the idea of sustained commitment to a community, a group, a people, a cause that you have, I think that's really what will help us sort of show that we deserve trust, you know, to work with communities and on causes that are really important. And so that's what I'll leave you with today. I've already talked with a few of the people who have a lot more to add to this kind of conversation, so I look forward to continuing the conversation. Thanks. I think I have a couple minutes. If anybody has questions or wants to talk about any of this stuff, I'm happy to. That's always been a challenge, and well, Parsons, they're pretty supportive of ways of support. If you have an idea that needs more time, So when I first started talking with, on the Freshkills project in particular, John Roach and I were first talking, and we expected it would be one semester, but then we also started complaining about how all these projects for that one semester are just so limiting, and there's so much more potential for them. And so we've actually continued that project. It's now in its third class. So we started as a required studio for graduate students, and then we created an elective for all of Parsons, and actually all of the new school. And that was fascinating. We didn't have a huge number. We had about 10 students, but each one of them came from a different department. We had musicians, we had planners, we had sustainability, science-focused people. We had data visualization students. And so that was a way of continuing that. And now, so one thing I didn't describe is that in 2020, we're hoping to have dual exhibitions, one in Staten Island and one at Parsons. And so we have one class right now that's focused on curating this project. And so it's not taught by us, it's taught by one of our colleagues who has expertise in curation. And so that's another way of sort of continuing it. I don't know if it's gonna be another class after that, but we essentially have found ways to add them as electives through the school. And I don't know how the powers that be keep agreeing to it, but you know, we keep making the argument that, like, if we're really talking about impact and making a difference, then we need to extend it somehow. So that's the only way, really. And our partners, I mean, I can't speak well enough for our partners. They're just amazing. Along with Freshkills, we're also working with a tech company called Arable Labs. And that's where all the data comes from. They essentially have created this, like, little disk that you can plunk in the ground, and it gives you all these readings about the environment. They've been amazing to work with. The school's been amazing to work with, and it seems to have some legs based on their energy too. Yeah. That's the goal, and so couldn't go too deep into that, but it was so essentially. The students who are part of that project created a genetic algorithm. So, and I'll describe what that is. So basically, we would have four or five of these different sensors around the park, and they will be measuring different locations, obviously. So they will also be communicating with each other. And so if, when the music's playing back, say on a north mound, and the plants are really growing well, say on south mound, they're not growing so well, the algorithm would then change that the music from the north mound would then be played to the south mound as a way of seeing whether or not the plant growth would change. Great, yeah. This is the kind of project that we're just looking for more, anybody who wants to collaborate. And with that toolkit I mentioned, we're gonna be launching it in July of this year. And part of that's gonna be reaching out to people across the country who live, you know, teachers, advocates, people who are interested in this topic in general, as a way of sort of spreading the word and getting people to connect over it. Mm-hmm.
Data for every school inch, and there's actual ways you can measure the health of plants using that data.
Oh, yeah, we should talk. Yeah. That sounds good. Thanks. Great question. So I think we're always worried about those challenges of essentially making the, you know, community partners exhausted, because they get a lot of attention from school groups. Especially after Superstorm Sandy, everybody wanted to go to these areas that were just devastated and, as designers, do something. So there is a limited amount of attention that you can expect from them. And that's what we just try to keep it as efficient as possible. With that in mind. So in particular, the work that I'm doing with Mark Randall and World Studio, we have a set number of meetings that they sign up to be part of with us. So there's an expectation of connection with us and that they will have to participate. And you know, we have a couple ways that we essentially measure whether or not it was a good project from their point of view, even without waiting a couple of years to see how the neighborhood changes or how the organization improves. We have somebody, a writer, go out and actually record the story of the project as a way of hearing more feedback from them about what we can do differently, but also about what was working well, opportunities for future collaboration and those kinds of things. In student groups in particular, that's a real challenge, and one that I don't think we've necessarily been able to crack as well. But in the project that I showed, having those partners as, you know, great partners, the person from Freshkills, who's our main partner, she's probably shut up to 8 or 9 reviews. So they're very connected to the project, and they're very interested in seeing how it progresses. But I've worked with other groups in my past who are just way too busy to have that kind of conversation on a regular basis, and so they've been more out to lunch in that regard. Well-meaning, but just not able to dedicate time. So I think it's an ongoing challenge that all of us face who teach these kinds of work. Done? Okay. Maybe we can talk after. Quick question? It is.
Because
yeah.
We need so much. We really need that.
Yep.
And that again is a distribution.
Absolutely.
Very happy with very little and still pretty much good life.
Yeah.
So grappling with those issues becomes weird.
Mm-hmm.
As designers, we often don't get to do that as much. We think of that as outside.
Mm-hmm. It's actually right. And in the book, they actually talk about that a little bit more, because of course we can't design for every personal scarcity and even know what those are. That would take a long time to understand. But I think the impulse or the interest in doing that seems to be heading in a direction that, at least for me, I'm more interested in, because I feel like when we talk about empathy, a lot of times it seems jargony. You know, it's like, okay, we're going to be empathizing with a user that we never really talked to, but we create these really nice charts, or we've created sort of a sketch of what they might look like or what they might experience. And so interviews are a great way of getting closer, but I just feel like it requires a lot of close connections. And distribution is a great point. A lot of this is logistics, too. Well, I need to go, but I actually was going to show one project specifically about that, so we should talk more afterwards. Thanks.
morning. My name's Diana Baldy. I grew up in Martins Ferry, Ohio, which is across the river from Wheeling, West Virginia, a steel town, as might be familiar to many of you. And so we're going to talk about time banking for the next few minutes. It's going to be quite a change from a prior speaker. I don't do any graphic design. But we'll talk about what time banking is and how it works and some of the challenges that you face and some success or ways to maybe be successful. My husband and I, we've traveled quite a bit. We've lived in several states and parts of the world. Let's see. Thank you. Okay. And so I guess I grew up in Martins Ferry where people helped each other. You know, you saw your parents helping out at school or at church, and so that spirit of volunteerism followed us. And so in Chicago area, we've worked with Destination Imagination, a children's group, 20 years, and then we dropped into Phoenixville a couple years ago, and we knew no one. No one, right? And so we also brought my mother-in-law and sister-in-law, who were highly dependent, with us from New Mexico. And their health really failed. So we were really struggling with how do we get along, how do we find help for them, how do we meet new people. And there was a social event from the Time Bank. And so we went to enjoy some food, and again, we were trying to meet people, so we would try to go to different things. And in that room, it was really kind of amazing. You know, we met a guy who was literally living on about $4,000 a year, and he was happy. He kind of gets to your point of view of he's happy with what he has, and he was there giving his time to other people. And he was thrilled to be able to ask for a ride to the doctor's appointment or to do something where he could ask amongst this community and get help. And so when people needed help, he was right there to help others as well. And so as someone that was kind of introducing us to the group said, yeah, this person, when I lost my job, they helped me, you know, make a resume. And this person helped me with this, and that person does this. And everybody in the room had some sort of a connection of helping each other. And then Orion Communities, this is a nonprofit organization in a town who 40% of their clients are homeless. The rest are in some sort of a transition in life. And they help them become more resilient and kind of they're just a really great group. And so they introduced us to Orion, and we walked in and said, hey, we need help with our family members. They said, oh, and they gave us a list, Department of Health, and do this and do that. And so our Time Bank is a formal partner with several nonprofits in the area. And that means that when they need volunteers, they can put out a request to our group. And then, again, these folks that have a sense of volunteerism can rise to the challenge. So my real job for many years has been a management consultant. So I go into organizations, a whole wide variety of organizations, and assess their systems and help them streamline and improve, help with strategic planning and that. So for the Time Bank in 2008, I helped analyze the data that we had and really look at some of the challenges, and we kind of did the strategic plan. And then a few months later, they said, oh, by the way, could you be our president and kind of lead us into the future. And you'll see some of the challenges around that. So So I want to give a proper credit to Edgar Kahn, because a long time ago, he really, it's like a visionary, right? Like, he had his own event where he became unable to do some things. And at the end of the presentation, I have a reference where you can go see the video about his life story and how he really started to look at the value of people. He wrote a book, No More Throwaway People. And his commitment to social justice is around when you kind of stereotype someone as a receiver, someone that has to be supported to have living conditions, that you often forget about the value that they have. And that's especially true when you look at that through the eyes of a market economy, where everything you do is based on money. And so some people's time is worth more. And so, but when you think about all the things that you do, like keeping your household in order and having companionship, those things are what you have to have in order to have a community, that the market doesn't place any value on that. But yet it's really valuable. You really wouldn't get along without that. And so the whole idea of time banking was built around social justice, reducing isolation. And it doesn't matter how much money you make or where you live, we all can feel that sense of isolation. And some can feel it, you know, much more dramatically than others, but it's an inherent thing that creeps up on each of us from time to time. And then how do you get the community? Again, when we moved from Annapolis, after 6 years, we met our neighbors at the yard sale when they wanted to see what bargain they could get. Never saw these people, never met them. And that's unfortunately our new neighborhoods, right, where you don't know the people that are by you. The other big driver for Edgar is basically recognizing civic engagement or volunteerism. And so the idea of if I do something, if I do something for you, sir, it takes me an hour, I get a time dollar. It's an imaginary time dollar. There's no value to it. But now that I'm rich because I have this imaginary thing, and then when our daughter moved, we could put out a request and say, hey, anybody have a truck? We have a few pieces of furniture she's trying to get from the ReStore. And someone says, hey, absolutely. And then we give them the time dollar. So that's the basics of time banking. So our core values is that each and every one of us has assets. Every single person, and that we need to honor all types of work, whether that, again, is something as simple as companionship or a ride to the airport, or whether you're doing, again, my helping with a strategic plan. If I were doing that with a corporate client, I would have given them a nice size bill. But those hours were valued as $1, one-time dollar. Also with volunteerism, this might be, again, where you might think of the JCs and Kiwanis and Rotary. Their whole vision is about giving and doing things for the community. With time banking, it's really essential to be two-way. Now, can you already hear yourself thinking, well, I don't need anything, or I don't know that I'd want to ask for that, because there's some vulnerability around that, and vulnerability and shame follows pretty closely behind that. And so it's one of the things that we really have to work on is that freedom to be able to make a request as well as offer your talent. So we do a social every month, and it's really just so people become less afraid of each other. You know, because of the time bank, you see a list of people and their talents, But once I meet you, I'm like, oh, well, you're not so dangerous. I might trust you to walk my dog. Right? And then the idea of respect. Or I might need, you know, I would allow you to come into my home or to work together. So the Phoenixville area, which is where this time bank is, it was an old town. It's got a lot of historic places. As the steel mill closed down in the last hot coil was 76, I think, and then the entire factory was closed in 87. But because, I mean, the Phoenix, we've really come up with the rise of the Phoenix. So the mill was demolished. There's now apartment complexes there. Small businesses have moved in. But I think fundamentally what makes unique Phoenixville unique is that not only are there 60 nonprofits in a pretty small town, but they work together. And it's a network and it's a collaborative spirit. They've also, I don't know if you've heard of Transition Town, but Media Pennsylvania has been spearheading efforts, and we have a pretty significant effort in Phoenixville. And Transition Town is, again, one of the references at the back. But to give you a sense, there's downtown. I mean, the mill was right downtown. And as we talked about the smoke and the people living around there, the air quality is not that. But now, all those buildings on the right, those are all apartment complexes. So we lived in one of the U-shaped ones. There were 350 apartments now in that one place. They kept the foundry. It's now like one of the best places or sought after places for weddings. It's been restored. There's been a lot of effort there. So our time bank started. Edgar actually came to town, went to Camp Hill Sultane. It's an organization that helps folks with disabilities be accepted and respected. And so a fiscal sponsor helped us get started. And then we're one of few time banks in the United States that actually maintains the 501c3 status. And so far we have about 40, we're close to 42 now. So the idea of enhancing volunteerism, that you generate this idea of self-worth because your time is valued. So we've talked about that. So how could we do it? Well, it could be from one individual to another individual. Now, when you know them, that's pretty easy, but at the beginning, that might be a little scary. And that's, again, one of the reasons we do the socials, so people understand that once you share time with someone, you build that trust. Or in one of the pictures, we were at a garden where someone had a garden, was kind of overgrown, so about six of us came and we were in the mud and weeding. We had three big wheelbarrows of weeds, right? But weeding a garden is boring by yourself, but in a group where you could chatter, it kind of makes work fun. And then this particular lady actually rewarded us with a homemade pie, right? So then our partner organizations, we have the Code Blue, which is a warming center where folks without a bed can go and sleep at night and during the winter. And so we have groups of people that help with laundry and inventory. And with Orion, we help them with a variety of initiatives that they do. So again, we could go as a group or we could go as individuals. For me, the Park House Rehabilitation Center, a nursing home, that was one where I met Melinda. She wasn't scary. And she said, oh, yeah, come on out. When they do events, they just need people to help move the wheelchairs from the floors down to the entertainment center. And so that's how I get my Fitbit steps in, right, by just going there. But again, as a group, like I might not go to a nursing home as an individual. It's a bit scary. But as part of a group, it's a lot easier to say yes. So you need some sort of a system where people can make offers and make requests. And so you need some sort of an exchange system. So this could be pen and paper, whether it's a bulletin board, whether it's virtual or paper, or you could have a simple thing. Now, that graphic doesn't show up, but it's actually a nice, one of the ones in Germany made, looks like an actual bill. So they, again, they just hand off the bill when they do their exchanges. And then for the software, there's two main ones that I've been able to find: Community Weaver, which is part of Time Banks USA, and Time and Talent, which is part of another network of Time Banks called Our World. So these are just some of the statistics about the two different organizations. One of the things I find, Community Weaver just started to charge a fee for the software, because as any of you that work with software know, there is a lot of work to maintain things and make improvements. But the percentage of Time Banks that are active is much higher on the Time Bank USA than on the Our World. I think because there's no fee, people start up and they don't realize that there are challenges and it's not going to just happen automatically. So the idea that I don't have anything to give, we see that in every demographic. I don't know what I have. Well, then we make a list, right? Or I don't need anything. Recruiting people and keeping people engaged and then keeping track of the hours. So this is our statistics of when we started up. The yellow line is the membership. And then the orange is who joined, right? Those are the enthusiastic folks. And then the gray is who dropped out. So my point about this is that you need someone, that there's going to be a churn of people in and out, but you need some sort of a coordinator that's helping people make, to stay engaged. And you, so that leadership or how you're going to manage the exchanges, governance, if you're going to do this, whether it's going to be a formal organization or informal, again, we're a little more formal, so we need to have insurance and places to do things. So when we start helping other time banks start up, one of the things that Joel does is have them list all the resources you already have in the area. Who are the movers and shakers? What are the needs? What are the assets that you have? And then, who's the core group going to be that are aligned with these core values? There's a new website that's started up from gatheringwithapurpose.net, and they have a few things where, again, where you could do an event and you could have half the people in the room get a card that says you're going to ask for something, the other half get a card that say, I'm going to do something for somebody. And so you go through the emotions of time banking, and you meet again and talk about the experience of doing the exchange. And so we think this is going to be a great way to have time bank start, where the people understand the emotional parts of time banking before they just sign up and say it sounds like a good thing. So we're hoping this will help maintain engagement. And then there are other mentor time banks that could help you. Decide, all these things. We do have limits of support. So, for example, we don't do personal care like bathing or giving medicine, things that there are other organizations that have certification of personnel and training. And again, depending on how you set up. So in summary, it's a great concept. Like, I'm so excited. We've done a lot of work this past 6 months on just refining bylaws and core procedures and setting up the framework to get ready to turn over to have it be a more sustainable organization. The fact that we've made it 15 years is really good, but we want to get ready for the next 15. And as long as you go into it understanding that there's going to be some effort to keep it moving, it'd be great. And I wanted to extend the invitation. Edgar Dr. Khan turned 83 March 23rd. He's a visionary of our time. He's also a really nice person. He's coming to Phoenixville April 28th at 7 o'clock, and we'd love, if you'd like to meet him and carry on the discussion, you're very welcome. Our website has a way you can make a reservation. And then there's some resources for you. And the top one on here says, well, you want to start as a formal group going all the way to a legal entity, just some of the things to think about there. And Transition Town is another initiative about equity that, again, I thought this group would be interested in. So I know it's probably time for break. I'd be glad I brought one of our new brochures and my cards, and be glad to chat with folks informally, because I think we don't have time for questions. But thank you.
Hello, 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 hello. Whoa, we need Viagra for the mic stand. Check, check, check. Hey, there's voice. What do you know? Will that work for you? All right. So, Eve, are you going to kind of describe what this is, or are we just jumping into it?
I could describe it.
Right.
Oh, I have a voice. So, Chris and I are going to talk about what we do with one community around here that's actually 13 communities making up Scott's Run. And so we also are going to be talking about how you tell a story, and one certain way everyone knows how to tell a story is through a song. So you're first going to hear a story about Scott's Run written by Chris Haddix in communicate, and as you can see, along with the community. So
while Eve's figuring that stuff out, I had written a song about one of the little communities in the string of communities years ago, and I was asked to come perform that song for this community and kind of maybe include it as part of the talk.
You better go.
Ready to go. Okay. Tell you about this place that we call Scott's Run. The American Indian made the first claim, and the ships and their dreamers across the oceans they came. The creek was given an old Irish name, and it came to be known as Scott's Run. The woods were soon and the farming began. The earth was turned up by the plow and the hand. The family could make its own way on this land. Life was good up and down Scott's Run. There was coal at their feet in that thick Pittsburgh seam, but the farm life remained the mountaineer's dream. Then the world went to war in 1914 and brought changes along Scott's Run. Boats started sailing from Europe again, and the trains from the south brought in more working men. Cheap muscle was needed to load up the bins with the coal that lay under Scott's Run. Shoulder to shoulder, all day and all night, Italians, Hungarians, blacks and whites, they were all poured together and made it all right. It was all for one on Scott's Run. They lived in close quarters in company shacks. They watched money leave by the ton down the tracks. Great fortunes were made on poor men's backs. Life was hard up and down Scott's Run. But hard though it was, people still say they wouldn't take nothing in trade for those days. You can count on your neighbor in every way. It was family out there on Scott's Run. The mines, they ran safe up until 42. Then the mines started blowing like they're prone to do. lines went away, the houses came down, and the tipples decayed. It was sad goodbyes as folks went on their way. They never went far from Scott's Run. The world seemed content just to cover its eyes, saying some have to sink so that others can rise. They built their new highway, passed her on by, washing their hands of Scott's Run. But some stuck around, they're no strangers to sweat. And if you are a gambler, well, you better not bet that the end has arrived, 'cause it ain't over yet. There's new life springing up on Scott's Run. 7 miles long, from its head to its mouth, joins with the Mon coming up from the south. Pull up a chair and I'll tell you about this place that we call Scott's Run.
So sometimes working in the community is like a love story. What did I do now? I pushed the same thing you pushed. No, it's a new one. So can I? I'm just going to use the arrow. Okay. So it's about a love story. So about 7 years ago now, Carrie Staten and the Brownfields had an event, and they invited a whole bunch of university folks to come sit in with 8 communities that had a problem. And our problem was this kind of eyesore there. And so in quick order, we were supposed to come up with a plan and see if we could win $5,000 to do that. This was our suggestion. We didn't win, but we still liked each other. And so now we've been working together for 7 years. And the first thing we did is what designers do. We actually with Ron Delaney, he was on our same team. He's now one of our city councilmen and in the Davis College. We had a visioning meeting with all people that were invited from all 13 communities, and we came up with that. And one of the things we performed some brochures and things like that for them, but we wanted to go further and help them reach some of their visioning things. And part of that involved helping them tell their story to the world. The story that you just heard, that's part of it. That's a sadder part of it than a lot of things that happen. But so how do we tell that story? So one way we tell it is we immerse ourselves. And we actually follow the book that Andrew Shea wrote 7 years ago. It's our textbook. So we immersed ourselves. That's number one, what you do. And that was so that the students could get a sense of what that community was like. And we could get a sense that we're trustworthy. So we painted a bunch of buildings in preparation for their street fair, which is a big annual event. That's the thing for it. And then some of their story has to do with not what you'd expect from a community that is like the steel town you were just hearing about from Diana. That went by itself. But their story is one about immigration, those 19 countries that provided coal miners when there wasn't enough from the mines that were starting up in World War I. But they also have lots of stories about how they were way, way ahead of the civil rights movement in terms of integration, because they were all poor together, as was in the song you just heard. So we looked at stories from people who are right there telling them to us right now. This is Sarah Little, who's the president of the museum, and one of her stories is that she got up close and personal with Franklin D. Roosevelt in 1942 to sing with him. And those of us who have known Al Anderson in this town know that he was a rock and roll star in the 60s with Billy Ward and the Dominoes, and he kept that music in D.C. for about 20 years and came back to here and brought it to us. There are bigger stories than that, too. Sometimes they've turned into documentaries. This is one that was a guy from the Netherlands who, as a Boy Scout, was taking care of this grave and came over here to find out who he was taking care of, and that turned into a whole documentary. There's a story about what I mean by integration. This miner's pool in 1946 was integrated. You know, that wasn't happening anywhere. And there are love stories among the various folks. And that's one of the people in that last photograph. So there we are, trying to get along with the community and learn something intergenerationally about divides. And Mary Jane Coulter was one of those people who first came to that meeting, and she's sitting here with us today, and became the director of the museum that was kind of rose from the ashes like the phoenix. And so these are artifacts from an earlier version of the museum, and what we started with when we decided to collaborate and put the museum back together. And when we were thinking about that, the Flying Colors, which is a gospel group from that area, and the Steel Drums, which is a factory that's right there in Osage, performed for us and gave us another sense of what their kind of history was like. And because that wall, there was a lot of 3D artifacts, and the wall didn't have a lot of space, we decided to just design it. Well, the winning design that the community liked the best was this big stripe around the wall. And so we made that big stripe around the wall, and then we added graphics to it. And it started to tell a story now, and it got a little bit more three-dimensional. And we really have a wonderful trove of photography, because the Farm Security Administration sent photographers like Walker Evans here, and now hundreds and maybe 1,000 photographs exist that we can make use of from 1935 and 38. So we like making stuff in our department. I think we do. I propose that we do. And so we make books, among other things, and the books can be handmade. We have a book arts course, and we have letterpress, and we have silk screen, and we have a printmaking department, too. So these are us making books. And we made, in this case, an edition of like 5 or 6 books of these that came from interviews with the residents of Scott's Run. And that's what some of them looked like. They weren't all traditional. Some were flag books and accordion books and different kinds of things. And they ended up in geocaches as the log books. And we planted those geocaches around the 13 communities. I don't know how they're doing. We don't check them very often. But it had other little treasures in there. And so another way to tell a story was through murals, which is pretty traditional. And this was a good candidate. This wall could use some love. And this was one of the, well, this was the winning idea for a mural for that. And we did it in our studio. We just projected things on the wall and did the parts, and all the parts had to go on this wall that had to be bumped out because there was a gas line running right along the wall. And that's what I mean, we make stuff. And then we started putting them up, and then eventually it looked like a mural. And that was Al Anderson being a tour guide for it. And we got involved with this guy who knew about synergistic gardens. And so the place the wall was, and the concrete pad, had been where a movie theater that was in important to the town, but it burned down a long time ago. So we gave it some new life too. And the raised garden of synergistic techniques was all his secrets. But and then in the back, we've got a really fancy tomato steak with the piece made out of metal. And it produced. So that giant squash is from seeds that Lou Baracus got from Crete. And inside of that is the most delicious, and it lasts forever, orange fruit. And you can see how big it is. That's my grandson. And in that garden, we put garden signs that told stories about food. And this particular one is one of my favorites because I got to meet Alfred Jones, and he was 101 when I met him, and he said the secret to his long life was eating a sweet potato every day. And then we moved on to storytelling through song, and got Chris engaged with a grant to write not one but two songs. And you'll hear the second one on Saturday at the coffee break. He's scheduled to play for us there. We also decided we could help businesses out by offering signs that were of the vintage of the heyday and are the fun kind of designs we like anyway. And so Al's using his right now at a shoe shop. And the guy in this picture had been taking circuit camera pictures for probably 20-some years, and they're hard to display because they're 8 feet long. So we made this carousel that would let them display that and give them a place to identify the people in that one. And sometimes we call this the Scotts Run Museum and Trail because it doesn't just stay inside, it goes outside. And so this interpretive sign was on a bench and told four stories in the slats there. And so what happened is that the museum has become a third place. And a third place, if you're not familiar with the term, is something that's not your house and it's not your school or your work. It's the third place you hang out. And here's another one of those extended trails, interpretive signs that we put on buildings that can show what life was like at the heyday. And we've done now 7 street fairs, helped in whatever way could be kind of fun. And in this case, we're silk screening t-shirts of hand-lettered quotes that the community liked. And this is another of those shirts, and a glimpse of the steel band that was playing. We even helped make a fundraiser of a 5K and ran in it, and Kofi, my colleague, won. And this is an intergenerational thing that we did, telling stories by making with tweens, young teens, and not even teens, they were like 9 and 11, building dollhouses to the specs of what the coal camp houses looked like, being told, and the people who live there, you can see Sarah Little's image on there, and what you can't see very well is that there's a wonderful story that she told that's written on the slats of the house. So we call it These Walls Can Talk. And we've tried making it into kind of a makerspace of its own. And then currently we're doing children's books that will go to the schools that were, or the Milan school that was consolidated from these communities. And those are some of the authors that are inspecting their work. And this book is kind of a memorial. It's Lou Baracus, who was in the last slide, had painstakingly gone through the news microfilm for like 40 years worth of mine accidents. And each one of these pages is 370 pages contains an accident that either maimed or killed someone. But they all have a big music tradition, too. So Miss Sarah, who sang for President Roosevelt, also just went to Uganda this October and sang while she was there at age 94. And we made a CD out of the songs Chris had and all of the songs from the community that we thought would make a good story. And our dean at the time, Paul Kreider, said, and he was an opera singer, so I wasn't sure what he would think of this, but he loved it, and he said, we should do this. And we got to perform this whole CD at the Met, and we filled the house. A few shots from that. And part of it was allowing some of the community members to be part of this. This was a piece Chris wrote that used all the, it was an immigrant story. And now the next phase of this is Liza High School is turning it into a documentary that you might see on TV at some point. So that's some of the ways that designers can help tell stories, and we're looking for more. We seem to keep finding new ways. So that's that. Thank you. So you have now earned your coffee break, and I tried to get them to stay, keeping the food and coffee up there, so let's go enjoy it. I think there's some music up there for you as well.